So, my name is Stefan Christgau. I'm a research associate, as Matthias introduced me here at the Zuse Institute in Berlin. And today I want to give you a presentation on a case study that we made in the past on an early access phase of the OneAPI environment. And the application is named EasyWave, which is a tsunami application. And with me here is in the background hiding Marius Knaust. He is eager to answer FPGA related questions. We have some parts in this presentation on FPGAs, but feel free to answer more questions, to ask more questions related to FPGAs within this session or even afterwards. So at the beginning, I would like to say that this work was partially done within the research campus Modal in the HPC lab here at the IB, which is funded by the German Ministry of Research and Education. So as a refreshing part of this talk, I would like to remember you or remind you of what this is all about. So OneAPI basically addresses the trend for heterogeneous architectures. So so the time for having a single CPU in your system is over, is long over, and the trend is that you will have different kind of accelerators or special purpose hardware in your system that you needs to be addressed and needs to be programmed. And for that, OneAPI is here, as you have learned yesterday already. And OneAPI promise you that you have a common developer experience across the architectures of these all different accelerator types. And one question is that we have already addressed in a talk yesterday by Igor, that you may have CUDA code that is very tightly coupled to your NVIDIA hardware that you may have purchased already. And now you have to transition to use OneAPI from your CUDA code to data parallel C++ code. Since data parallel C++ is a programming language of choice in the OneAPI environment. So, and you all also learned yesterday that for this step, so bringing code from CUDA to DPC++, you have the compatibility tool available, which helps you in the process of transferring code from one language to another. So then you have the DPC++ code, and the question is on which architectures can I actually run the code? What do I really gain from it, from this migration process? And can I even use my already purchased NVIDIA hardware? And these questions I'd like to address in this presentation, and we will also have some demos on how actually it is working. However, I'd like to know from you which programming frameworks are you familiar with when you, if you have experience with GPUs. So Matthias, if you just would open the poll, it would be interesting from the audience to know if you have used some programming frameworks for GPUs programming or not. And if you have, which did you use in the past? So we also had a similar poll yesterday, and the trend was quite clear there. However, it was more restricted to did you use CUDA or not. And this is a more fine-grained poll today. And the trend is that I can tell you from my perspective here that 50% of the people have experience with CUDA, and about a third with OpenCL, and also some people have experience with SQL. And which was also surprising is that a lot of people are using OpenMP for GPU programming, and I'd like to share the results, and I think this is not something we should hide for you or from you. So only a minority doesn't have experience with GPUs, which is a good thing, I think. And most people either use CUDA or OpenMP. And for the CUDA guys, this talk is will bring you, or will show you some differences between DPC++. We will underline some differences between the programming paradigm in CUDA and DPC++ or SQL. And for the others, I think the demos will be nice for you as well. So now we take a look at the agenda. So we have a closer look on EasyWave in a short some seconds, and then we will actually migrate the code from CUDA to OneAPI, and we will also have a look at how can we be more SQL-esque, as I will call it in this talk. So how can we be more compliant to the SQL standard, so to say. And then there will also be some demos on how we can actually use different architectures. And obviously there will also be a conclusion. What is maybe important for you as an attendee to this workshop, there is a playbook. I think if it's not already available, it will be available soon on the website of the workshops. In this playbook, you can you find introductions how you can reproduce most, if not all, of the demos that I am going to present here. However, some steps you may have to do on your own. So this is only a guideline, so to say, and not everything will automatically work for you, but it's an opportunity to reconsider what I've shown in this presentation here. So now we have a closer look on the application. So as I mentioned, it is named EasyWave. This is not an application that was developed by us. However, we made a lot of experiences using this application in the context of OneAPI. Originally, it was developed by the German Research Center for Geosciences, and in collaboration with the University of Potsdam, it was brought to GPUs, especially CUDA GPUs. And what this application is about, it is an application that computes the propagation of a tsunami wave in case of a seismic event, so an earthquake inside an ocean, for example. And in an early warning center, which is responsible for detecting any hazard related to FPGAs to the public, it is the responsibility of the early warning center to estimate to disseminate warnings in case of a tsunami, and if the tsunami is really a hazard, has to be checked. And that's the purpose of EasyWave. So here's a nice visualization that we made. So this is a visualization of what the data that is actually computed. So the maximum wave height of a tsunami wave. And as you can see, the wave propagates over the time over the ocean. And this is also a feature of the application, that the actual compute domains propagate, so to say, with the simulated wave. So what you are interested in an early warning center is how large or how tall is the wave when it comes to the coastline. And depending on the height, you inform the public and take countermeasures and so on to minimize the danger for the public. The code base is actually written in C++, and it has different code paths for supporting both CPUs and GPUs, so CUDA GPUs in this case. And to abstract from these different programming models and these different platforms, it uses C++ classes. And so as a consequence, you have different code paths here. So if you want to change your computational model, you have to maintain different code paths here, which is also a matter of concern if you have different support for different architectures inside your application. And with OneAPI, you may have the chance to merge all these code paths into one and support different architectures. However, we will also note in this talk that there might be some limitations on this approach. So the application itself is a typical stencil application. It is not a very complex application. It is a usual stencil computation that is memory bound in this case. And as I said, it uses a dynamically growing compute domain. And to outline the code a little bit, as I said, we have a typical stencil code, and it uses a lot of stuff that maybe CUDA developers, since we have a lot of them in the audience, are familiar with, and I will show you some things in the source code. For example, in the code that has these different classes, as you can see here, you have this class for the GPU node, and there's a method that is called malloc memory. And this does memory allocations for the compute domain. And this is a natural thing, since you have a two-dimensional A compute domain, an easy way if you actually do two-dimensional memory allocations, which is a crucial thing in CUDA, since you would like to have memory accesses aligned and so on. So you use special memory operations or memory management operations to allocate the memory here. And you also have one-dimensional data, and for this you use a conventional CUDA malloc operation. However, you also know that you have these CUDA call macros here, which are actually preprocessor macros that check if an operation return CUDA success, and if not, this is a typical thing. You print out an error and return from your routine with an error code, for example. So this is how I think very much or a lot of CUDA applications are designed or written. And if you look to the source code even further, and I mentioned it, but the source code is open source, so you can go ahead and download it as well and study it as well. So then you have the typical thing, if you're not using special features of CUDA, that you do memory transfers from the host side to the device. And you do this for the two-dimensional data and also for the one-dimensional data here. And there's also the other way around, that you copy data from the device to the host to evaluate data that you computed on the GPU, for example. And the most important thing, of course, is that you want to run your kernels, so your actual computation. And what you can see here, and this is also a thing that most CUDA code share, is that you first compute how many threads you want to use. In this two-dimensional application, we want to use the two-dimensional mapping feature of CUDA here. So we compute the number of threads in X and Y dimension. And then we compute from our domain size, so to say, from our iteration space, the number of blocks that we want to use in CUDA, which is, I think, a quite low-level detail of the architecture, but you have to do this in CUDA. And with this information, you actually launch your kernel with a function call-like statement with this fancy syntax here where you specify the number of blocks and threads. And you also pass, this is in this case, a data structure or a class to the kernel, which contains all the data that has been allocated beforehand. And since we are interested, or the application developers were originally interested, how long the individual kernels take when they are executed, we use CUDA events to measure the time that it takes for the kernel to execute. And if all kernels have to be finished, there is a synchronization with the device that actually takes care of that all kernels have been finished. And after that, we are safe to compute how much time the individual kernel take. And this is also done here. So this is a very typical code on the host side. On the device side, the kernels, as I said, are quite pretty straightforward. They are typical stencils. So we compute our position in the overall compute domain with these implicit variables like block index, block dim, and thread index, and so on. And then we go ahead with this index that we computed and access our data by the means of pointers as we are used to it from C and also for CUDA, obviously. So this is just a quick tour through the source code. And I listed the things that I pointed out here as well, but the demo, I think, is here much clearer. So now we had a look at the CUDA code, and the question is now, how can we get to the Data Privacy++ code? And as I already mentioned, and you hopefully learned yesterday, for this purpose, you have the compatibility tool, which assists you in this migration process. And we will use the approach that was also shown or presented yesterday with the compilation database in this case. And this is the first thing I want to actually show you here. So I have a checkout of the Git repository here, and I have some files open here in VI, so I have these swap files, but otherwise this code is clean, so I have didn't have modified anything. If you want to really have a look at the Git repository, you will notice that this is the latest version available here. So now I'm on a system where we actually have a CUDA CPU, a GPU installed, and I want to show you that the code actually is able to compile. So I just want to issue the bootstrap script here. So I want to do the bootstrap process, which actually generates a configure script. This is a usual compilation process you may are used to from Linux. So we now have detected that there's also a CUDA runtime available, or toolchain available here. So we have a make file generated. And if I issue a make, parallel make to speed things a little bit up, then we should also end up with a binary shortly. So, okay, here we go. So in source, there should be an EasyWave application or binary available, which is actually the case. So, and then we need to run EasyWave, and to run EasyWave, you don't just can issue the EasyWave command. You have to specify some more things here. However, I prepared that a little bit, and I'm using here this nice feature of the shell to actually run the code, but I have to be in the directory where the binary is. So now we have EasyWave up and running. It's starting, and we get a nice output of how long the actual simulation run, in this case about 1.7 seconds on the GPU, and it modeled around 10 or it modeled 10 hours of simulated tsunami propagation, so to say. So we can remember this number here, so 1.7 seconds for runtime on a NVIDIA GPU. This is actually a quite powerful GPU. We have a P100 installed here on the system, actually two of them. So this is actually really a powerful GPU. However, my promise was here to show you the actual migration process. And this is the thing I want to show you right now. So just to remind you of a pitfall that was also hinted by Igor yesterday, I now want to intercept the make process with this intercept build command. Remember that I just built the source code, so actually if I invoke make, it wouldn't do anything, and so the intercept build command doesn't really have a chance of recording anything here as well. So what I have to do right now is to make to clean everything out, so remove all the outputs of the compilation process, and now I can do the intercept build command again with make attached to it, and we will see that all the commands are actually listed that would be executed by the compiler here. However, but the important thing is here that we now have a compile commands JSON file, which is the compilation database that was actually mentioned yesterday and also shown. But I show it here you again. You can see that it records all the commands that have been executed here on the machine to compile the source code, and we record all the flags and all the directories where the code actually is stored in. So now I want to do the actual migration process. For this, I create a directory and I call it dpc++ or dpcpp. And now I want to issue the migration process, and I specify the inroot, which is the code directory. I want to store the output in the dpc++ directory that I just created, and I use the compilation database that we just generated with the intercept build command. Yes, I read in the chat that make b is make minus b is a nice thing. I know this as well, but I just want to show you that what make clean, that make clean is also a good thing here. So now we are using the compatibility tool to actually do the migration process. You see that the migration tool or the compatibility tool actually issues a lot of warnings. This is also a good thing. So don't just ignore these warnings. You have to take a look on your source code and check if this warning may be important for you. So in some cases, you can really ignore these. In some cases, you can't. So it is, and there's no guideline to you that which warning you could ignore or not. In general, just have a look at the source code and the warning related to it to actually have manual steps after the migration process. And you have to check if the migration process actually did the right thing here. However, now we ended up with source code, hopefully. So we take a look at the DPCP owner, and then should there be a directory named source. And this is actually the case. So we end up with the whole code base of EasyWave migrated to DPC++ if there was something to migrate. And yeah, now we have these different files here available, and we can also have a look at now at the one of the source code files. For example, we have this EW GPU node, which I showed you in the beginning as well. So the original CUDA code I show you, and now we take a quick look on how this actual file looks like now. Obviously, some header files have been replaced, but the one thing I want to show you here is the first thing is memory management. Here you have to notice two things. For these two-dimensional data elements or data arrays that EasyWave uses, the migration tool uses methods from the DPCT namespace. So this is actually a thing that you can use, but under the hood, it all maps to plain SQL code. And this is, let's say, an abbreviation or a convenience tool for you to have code that is in the first place readable for you. And you recognize this was a malloc operation, and you also may note that this is a two-dimensional memory memory allocation, since you pass two dimensions of your data here. However, if you want to migrate to real plain SQL code, you have to do something on your own at this particular place. So this is a thing that uses, or the memory operations here use methods from the DPCT namespace, from the compatibility tool. For one-dimensional data, there is a one-to-one mapping, so to say, to the SQL standard. So you have the SQL malloc device call here, actually. And you are free to change these calls here from the compatibility tool namespace to SQL calls as well. However, if you really want to have aligned memory accesses and management of pitch and so on, you would have to do it on your own. And the methods from the compatibility tool namespace here take care of this. But as I said, you have a chance to, or the opportunity to, rewrite it on your own purposes or your own needs. So, and then you also notice that you still have this CUDA call macro that you are used to from your CUDA code, so to say. However, there's also a warning emitted from the compatibility tool. Since the migrated code did not return any error code, so remember that the error handling in SQL is exception based, so there are no error codes you can check for in most cases. And therefore, the compatibility tool issued some other code. However, I'd like to show you that in the, oh, I just have to look which header file it is. I think this one, is it? No, it is not. How the macro actually changed as well. So the CUDA call macro that we used in CUDA has also been migrated from by the compatibility tool. It will print out an error if an error was actually detected. However, this is actually not fire since the error checking here in the migrated code is now exception based. However, the macro is also changed that way, and I think this is pretty impressive from our perspective. So coming back to my presentation, we already saw some differences between CUDA and DPC++ in this place on this particular code. However, you also noticed that the code is actually readable. And as I pointed out, you are free to change the code on your own. And since it is readable, you have a really good starting point for your further optimization process, rewriting or refactoring process, or yeah, tuning process as well. So the compatibility tool doesn't produce code that is garbled or so that you can't really read anymore, but it's instead it's really maintaining the original identifiers and so on, so you can work with the generated code base or the migrated code base as well. So now I want to highlight some differences between CUDA and SQL or DPC++ here in more details. And I don't want to show the source code here actually in most places. And I want to give a verbal explanation here. So one first thing you have to notice is when you migrate from CUDA to SQL, you have a change in how you deal with devices. So in CUDA, I think almost all, well, a lot of codes actually don't really care about multiple GPUs, and they just use a certain GPU, the default one, and you only deal with GPUs in that case. If you actually deal with multiple GPUs or CUDA GPUs on your system, you have to use an explicit call named CUDA set device to change the device that you're working with. Now, this is not really used in EasyWave. However, if you migrate to SQL or DPC++, you have to use a queue, as we have learned yesterday. And with the means of a queue, you are now more flexible. You don't really are bound to a GPU. You can write code for different platforms. However, with a queue, you are able to select which device or which platform you want to execute your kernel or your computation on. And this queue is your, so to say, token to access a device, and it's used for almost all routines, like for memory management and for kernel launch and so on. And for the compatibility tool generates code that looks like this, and it again uses fractions or data types and methods from the DPCT namespace. However, you can migrate away from these as well, but you have to be careful if you switch between queues, as Igor also pointed out yesterday. And the way you can control which device is actually used is you can either specify a so-called SQL device selector inside the source code. And if you don't do this, you can control the device from the outside with the help of environment variables. And we will see that this actually works as well later in this presentation. Concerning memory handling, I will just remind you of what we learned yesterday about unified shared memory. So unified shared memory actually provides you the opportunity to write code to have the migrated code look similar to what you are used to in CUDA. So this is actually quite convenient. So opposite to these buffers and accessors paradigms or concepts we have learned yesterday as well, this is really, unified shared memory is really a good thing if you are familiar with pointers. And if maybe you don't like buffers and accessors like I do. So on the one hand, these buffers and accessors have their pros. So they abstract you from accesses and from managing the data transfers and so on. But on the other hand, they make code likely to be verbose. And yeah, so in the end, I think it's a lot of personal preferences that plays a role here. However, with the unified shared memory, feature here that is used by the compatibility tool. And by default, you end up with code that you as a CUDA developer, which tries to migrate code from CUDA to SQL, you are familiar with that concept of pointers and so on. And so you are feel like more home, so to say, with this migrated code. And it's not a large gap between the CUDA, original CUDA code and the migrated SQL code. You have to deal with that if you directly migrate to buffers and indexes or CM. Concerning the kernel invocation, we saw that you basically in CUDA issue a function call with this fancy syntax here for blocks and thread specification. And you also know, if you are coming from CUDA, that kernel execution is asynchronous with respect to the host. And if you don't specify anything else, then you end up with all kernels inside a so-called stream here. So inside a default stream, if you specify nothing else. And in this stream, kernels are finally executed. In SQL or D++, you actually submit a so-called command group to the queue that you have created or you are using. And these group or these command groups then contain a kernel invocation. There are different types of kernel invocation, as we have seen yesterday. However, what is similar to CUDA here is that the kernel execution is actually asynchronous. However, the submit operation is something that happens synchronous on the host, so one after another, so to say. However, when it comes to the order of kernel execution, in CUDA, this is in order of the submission by default within the same stream. So as long as we don't use different streams, the order inside a stream is in order. So you don't end up with random ordering of kernels. If you want to use different streams on CUDA, you can define events and use them for dependency specification. In SQL, this is a little bit different. So you have again, queues where you submit the kernels to or the command groups to. However, the queues are out of order by default, as was pointed out yesterday as well. However, you have means to actually specify, so to say, the order of the kernel execution. If you are using the old in quote SQL standard, and which is still supported in SQL 2020 with this buffers and accessors scheme, so to say, dependency are automatically detected for you. However, if you migrate with the compatibility tool, by default, you end up with unified shared memory. And there must be another way to specify dependencies. And we learned yesterday about events. And this is actually the thing that we want to use. However, the compatibility tool keeps the order of kernel submission or kernel execution, to be more precisely here, with the help of wait calls on the queue. So if you have a sequence of wait or of kernel invocations, like for EasyWave in our particular example, the compatibility tool issues more or less a sequence of queue submit and wait operations. So they are basically blocking, so there's a blocking fashion of kernel execution here. So this maintains the order of execution, but it might be not that optimal. So you can specify things a little bit more better with events, as we will see later in this talk as well. What's different as well is how you specify how many kernel instances you want to actually execute. For the runtime or the hardware, need some information about that. And in CUDA, this is, from my perspective, kind of hardware oriented. So you specify the number of blocks and threads per block. And threads per block is basically a property of the streaming multiprocessor in the end. So it's, from my perspective, kind of low level. And also the number of blocks is kind of a low level detail here. So what you usually end up, and what is also what I've shown you with EasyWave, is that you usually have the problem size, and from that you derive the number of threads per block, or you specify the number of threads per block usually, and then you derive the number of blocks from this property and your problem size. So this is may not be the direct way for an application programmer to think of its problem, but this is more a hardware oriented perspective, as I said. In SQL or DBC++, this is more domain oriented. So you specify the range of your iteration space or your problem size, so to say. And this is what actually maps, so to say, to the number of work items. Or in, if you want to use CUDA language here, it's CUDA threads. You have the opportunity to group work items, and then you have the also the opportunity to control the number of threads per block, so to say, in CUDA, or the block size in CUDA. And then if you do this, you end up with an ND range, which gives you the options to specify the whole problem size and the number of threads per block or string multiprocessor, depending on the hardware that you're actually using. So you end up with more control over the hardware as well. However, you still provide the overall iteration space based on your problem size. And if you do the migration process, you may find in your original CUDA code magic numbers. For example, in the EasyWave code, you find those magic numbers as well. Since the authors found out that maybe a number of threads of 256 or so was optimal for their use case. And quite often, I think you will find the number of 1024 threads per block, which is, I think, almost for almost all CUDA architectures or compute capabilities, the same value as the maximum of numbers per threads per block, of threads per block. However, if you encounter these hard-coded values, you have to notice that this number may not be a portable thing. So you may end up with problems if you use this magic number. The compatibility tries best to warn you in this case, but have a look on your migrated source code as well when it comes to those magic numbers. Yes, concerning error handling, this is, I want to keep short, there are differences between the approaches here. So return value based things from the CUDA or CUDA C world versus the exception based approach in SQL or DBC++. And as we have shown, the compatibility tool migrates between them as well. For timing, as we have seen in EasyWave, the best practice used there is to measure the kernel executions with the help of events. And in on the migrated code for EasyWave, you will see that there is a synchronization that I already mentioned for kernel execution with the wait operation on the queue or the returned event. And then around this, the migration to, compatibility tool wraps calls to STD chrono clocks to measure the time before and after kernel invocation, and afterwards it computes the difference between them to actually get the runtime of a kernel. So the compatibility tool migrates and also detects these statements or these typical idioms here to measure kernel execution time, and it migrates to DPC++ here in a first approach. However, you may end up and find out that this may be not as optimal as you would like it to have, and then you can change the code based on your needs to have a better timing measurement, for example. And this also leads me to the question how we can be more SQL-esque here. Remember that the compatibility tool is a generic tool. It won't do magically convert everything for you. It won't produce very optimal code in every instance. So you have to start with your optimization or tuning or adjustment afterwards in any case. However, for EasyWave, as we will see shortly, we will have to do almost no changes with the very latest versions of the compatibility tool. So we were able to compile and run EasyWave quite fast for different architectures. However, the code, as I said, still needs improvements here. And you can choose from this list certain points, like you can define dependencies between kernels with the help of events, or replace memory functions from the DBCT headers with your own memory management functions, for example. So this is an incomplete list of possible improvements. And here is an example, which I don't want to describe in all details here. But the thing is that instead of having a sequence of wait, also submit operations and an immediate wait after each kernel submissions, you can use events for specifying dependencies and use these events also for timing measurements, and you can avoid these STD chrono operations shown here. And afterwards, a more condensed or optimized or tuned code would look like this, and it's also less verbose from my perspective and maybe more readable for you as well. So with that, I want to return to our demo and want to show you how we can actually execute code on different hardware architectures. So on this host where we migrated the code, so we have this migrated code available as we see in this DPCT folder here. We have this migrated code base. However, we don't have everything installed on the system, so that's why I'm shifting to my local workstation here, which has different architectures here available for one API execution, so to say. We have to be more verbose would be a good thing here. We have, for example, our integrated CPU here on my local workstation, and we also have integrated graphics here available on this platform as well. And we want to execute the migrated code base now. So again, I am here in this. I have a similar setup as on the other system. I have a clean checkout of the source code.
Devin, can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So we have a question. Once you migrate your code from CUDA to DPC++, are the number of code lines looks almost similar?
Well, yes. For EasyWave, we only had a minor increase, and this is almost only due to the kernel invocation. As I may show you here, it was in GP. This one here. The kernel invocation, which was originally one line, now becomes 9 lines. So this is actually the work that is required to submit a kernel here in DPC++. So this is the output of the migration process. But as I have shown you in the slides, you can also condense this to be more compact, so to say. But yes, in the overall, I think the difference between the number of lines here was minimal. Hope this answers the question. So as I said, we have a clean environment here, so we have nothing changed on the code base. And what I'm doing now is I don't want to do the migration process again. What I want to do is just copy the migrated code over here. So we now have the DPCPP code, DPC++ code again available. And now I'm using a make file that I can show you here right now, temp workshop. Material you can find this makefile in the playbook as well, in this archive that is provided there. The only thing I'm using here is I invoke the C++ compiler, which is now a DPCPP, so it is a DPC++ compiler, and I want to have specified the object files that I need to for the compilation process. This is all that is done here in this makefile. So I just want to start the compilation process, of course, with the makefile provided, and I have to go there. And now the compilation starts, and since my CPU is busy of bringing the video via Zoom to you, it is not the fastest right now. We have to be patient. So, oh, what is that? We have an error. That's too bad. So this is one thing that shows you that the compatibility tool will not automatically provide you with an 100% perfect solution here. It is a good starting point, a very good starting point, as I pointed out already, but you have to do some things on your own. And here's a very minor issue. Now Zoom warns me about high CPU usage impacts quality. Okay. So we have an issue with our source code. However, this issue is very minimal here. We have to provide some parentheses after X, Y, Z, and W here. And for that, we have a small patch available. It's also in the playbook, which is named post migration patch. And there you see that we make, or we add the parentheses after X, Y, and that. And in addition, we add a small print statement, so to say, that prints out the device that we want to use in, or that is in actually in use when we start the program. So I just apply the patch to our migrated code base here, and this works fine. This is good. And then I want to again make the code base here, so it compiles the remaining files. This may again take some time. Sorry for that, but we have to be patient. Maybe there's a question in the meantime.
Has somebody a question? Presently in the chat, there's no one.
Okay.
Can you explain how compatibility works with device selectors?
Well, actually, the code that is generated by the compatibility tool doesn't, as far as I know, provide code or generates code that includes device selectors. This is something you have to do on your own. But if I'm wrong, maybe Igor can step in and fix me.
Thank you.
Okay, so in the meantime, I think we are close to finish. Yes, exactly. So now we also have an EasyWave binary here. And again, I want to execute EasyWave here. However, since my CPU is not the fastest, as I said, I reduced the simulated time here to a minimum. And now we are executing everything here on the integrated graphics, which is also busy doing things. So this may take some time. So there's compilation process and so on. So however, the 1 hour simulates and it just runs. And we to have a little check on the results, we have these SSH max files here, which are so-called server grid file. And it has these dimensions. And now we change the device that we are using. And we specify circle device type here and switch from GPU, which was used here automatically, we switch to CPU. And now the code actually runs on a different platform. And we also see that the runtime is different. So obviously my CPU is busy doing other things, as I said. However, we can just check the output again. And as I said in the told you in the beginning, that the compute domain expands over time. So does this influences the actually result that is stored in this SSH max file. So if the dimensions of the resulting grid match, you can have some confidence in that your data is actually similar or identical between the different program runs, and also the minimum and maximums match between these versions. And we also have looked at this in more details, and we can say to you that the differences here when we actually look at the values are very minimal. So there are differences which came from differences between the architectures that are used to execute the program here and different optimization strategies for the different device types. However, the differences are really, really minimal. So with that, I have shown you that the code can actually run on, maybe I can terminate that here, can actually run on different device classes. I have shown you that we can execute on Intel CPUs and Intel GPUs. We have not only tested it on integrated graphics, we have also tested it on discrete graphics as well, and it runs there as well with the same binary. And this demonstrates that you can easily use Intel devices here without any trouble, at least for this code base. You can also use this binary or this code base for FPGAs, which is very exciting from our perspective. You can just use the DPC++ compiler and compile the code base with some different flags. You have to specify that you want to compile, so to say, for FPGAs, and which hardware you want to actually address with this compilation process, and then you are done. However, you need some time since the compilation process takes some hours. This is something that is inherited from FPGAs, so to say. So the actual compilation of the code is not the thing, but the actual generation of the hardware-specific bitstream, so to say, is the crucial thing here that costs you the time. And if you are familiar with FPGAs, then you may know that you have to manage the bitstream. Usually you have to bring that bitstream with your configuration of the FPGA to the FPGA and so on usually, but with the binary that is generated by the DPC++ compiler, you actually don't have to deal with that issue here. You just can run the binary. The only thing that you have to take care of is that you need a board support package on your FPGA that has support for OneAPI or OpenCL in that case. However, if you looked carefully at my CircleLS output here, you saw that we have a device class named ACC here available on the system. And this is available on each system that has the base toolkit installed, as far as I know. And if we switch the device type to ACC, we have an FPGA emulation device. So before you compile your code, and it takes hours to compile for an actual FPGA, you can run an emulation on your local CPU. And from our understanding is that the compiled circle code, which is compiled into SPIR-V from our understanding, is actually executed on the CPU in that case. So this will execute your code on the CPU, but it will emulate FPGAs to some extent. However, there are differences between your CPU and a real FPGA, especially when it comes to data types. So if you're using special data types like reduced widths of floating points or integers or so on, this is something the CPU cannot really do. So this is different, and we also had some problems with atomics in the past. So the simulation or emulation looks good, but the actual execution of the hardware wasn't really good. However, you can refer to the documentation for details in between emulation and FPGA execution. However, we think that this is really a great opportunity to bring FPGAs to the masses. So you don't have to do low-level programming with VHDL and so on. You can just write Circle code or C++ code, so to say, to program your FPGA. However, the code that you write must be or should be well suited for FPGAs. The EasyWave code isn't really a good code that runs well on an FPGA. It was we just tell you this here as a purpose for demonstration. if you have other codes and you want to address FPGAs with your code base, your code will likely have to be modified to be efficient on an FPGA. However, since you can program it on a high level, in a high level language, this gives you a lot more opportunity and a lot more, let's say, development speed over low level VHDL or Verilog designs. And so this is really, really a very interesting thing from our perspective. However, most of you are familiar with CUDA devices, as we learned from the poll. And the question now is, can we use our existing CUDA hardware that we also have in-house here? And remember that DPC++ is basically SQL or C++ plus SQL plus some extensions. And the only thing, in quotes, that you need to actually run codes on a new platform is a SQL implementation. And luckily, as we also learned yesterday, is that CodePlay, a company from Great Britain, or Scotland to be more precise, contributed to the open source Intel VM compiler with a backend that supports NVIDIA hardware here. And the only thing you have to do is you need the compiler, so you have to build this on your own, and you need to specify some flags for the compilation here. And I just want to show you that this is actually possible. So I have a build of this compiler available on my GPU platform here as well, and I want to show you that this is actually possible to execute the code again on NVIDIA GPUs. So we need to patch the code first, since remember that there was a bug or some things we need to fix. And I just want to switch to the right directory before I do that. And then I do the patch. And then I have a make file available. It's, again, this is also in the playbook, which is for CUDA. And there you can see that I invoke not DPC++, but the Clang++ or CLang++ compiler that I built on my own, and pass some flags like we have to enable SQL and SQL unnamed lambda, and specify the architecture that we want to address here, and some other specific things on my platform. And the rest is basically the same as on the other, in the other make file. And with that, I want to compile the source code. It warns me about an unknown CUDA version here, since I have CUDA 11 installed, but this is not an issue here. Compilation process may again take some time. I want to, if there are questions, I think Marius is on a good way to answer all these questions. Thanks, Marius, for that. If there are other questions in the meantime, I may answer them as well. This doesn't appear to be the case. So then we just wait for the compilation to finish. And maybe I can remind you of the magic number from our initial CUDA run. It was 1.7 seconds for a simulation of 10 hours. And we want to see if the compiled code works again, and also what the performance is here. Remember that I am using the mostly unmodified migrated code base here. So this is not optimized yet. And I won't go into details of optimizations here. I just want to name one if the compilation is finished, which I think should be the case anytime soon. This linking, okay. So now again, we have an EasyWave binary here, and I want to execute this command again. We don't need this, but so we are using our GPU again, as you have seen above. We're using the Tesla P100 here. Now we end up with a runtime of 1.9 seconds. Let's do some statistics and have another run. So again, 1.8, 1.9 seconds. This is a little bit more off, so to say, from the original execution. However, it is not that far away. And we also have, again, this SSH max file here. And we have these dimensions, and we can also have a look at the original file that was produced by the CUDA run. Oops, I don't want to CD there, I just want to check the file. And you can see that the grid dimensions are the same here again. And also the extent or the borders of the rectangle of the compute domain are the same here again. So computational wise, and trust me, we checked it in more details, is the output is almost identical to the original one. And just to convince you that performance may be not an issue here for EasyWave, I also have an older code base, sorry, that I tuned a little bit for the migrated code base. I tuned a little bit, and this is an older version, as you may notice, but it also runs on the P100 again, but the runtime here is also again in the range of 1.7 seconds. So you end up with only a marginal performance loss of about 5% or so. If you do the statistics, it will don't make a much difference here. So to return to my presentation, we have seen that we can actually use the binary or the compiler from the open source Intel LLVM compiler with this CUDA backend from CodePlay to execute the binary on CUDA hardware or the code base again on CUDA hardware. A nice thing here is that you can also use your existing ecosystem. You can still use your existing ecosystem, like your profiler that you are used to from NVIDIA, and also maybe also your debugger. I haven't tested the debugger, but I can tell you that the profiler works out of the box with that binary as well. So this leads me to a list of further resources. So if you are interested in migrating your existing CUDA code base, there are some very good documentation things, and also from the CodePlay company, there's a nice guide that helps you from getting from CUDA to SQL on your current knowledge from CUDA, so to say. And there are the other resources I think are obvious, and you can find this in the presentation slides available on the website as well. And with that, I want to conclude and will tell you that the compatibility tool is really a nice feature on nice add-on to the overall One API ecosystem. It relieves you from the tedious migration process. You don't have to do everything by hand. The generated code is a good starting point for further optimization and tuning. So it is, as I said, a starting point. It won't magically do everything for you. It is an assistance in your migrating process, so to say. Concerning the languages, we have seen that there are a lot of similar things between both of them, so between CUDA and SQL or DPC++. There are subtle differences which you need to be aware of when you migrate code. However, migrating to SQL or DPC++ really pays off with gained multi-platform support, which I hopefully you noticed and can take away from this talk that this is actually the case. With that, I want to say thank you for attending.